Say you want to body slam an outdoor shed, and it doesn't move, but you do the same thing to your niece's dollhouse, and you send the teddy bears flying. In this Layer for Psi MCAT video, we'll look at the forces of static and kinetic friction. Friction is a force that opposes motion, and we have two types. Static friction opposes the motion of something static or stationary, meaning it prevents a non-moving object from starting to move. Kinetic implies motion, therefore kinetic friction will slow down an object that is already in motion. Say you have a shed in your yard, and it's just sitting there minding its own business, not exerting any forces, right? Wrong. Don't forget that the shed is on Earth, and therefore is impacted by a downward force of gravity, which is opposed by an upward normal force. As I discuss in the previous videos, link below at layerforsci.com/forces. And there are no forces in the x direction, until you come along and you push the shed with your finger. Is the shed going to move? Not at all. But wait a minute, you just applied a force in the positive x direction. That means there has to be a counter force in the negative x direction to keep the shed stationary. And this is what static friction is all about. If you push on an object that isn't moving, that object is going to resist with static friction, with the exact amount of friction that you apply to the object so that it doesn't move. Now say you apply even more force and body slam the shed. You applied a much greater force in the positive x direction, but the shed countered with an exact equal force in the negative x direction. Once again, it's not moving. Until a monster truck comes along, slams into your shed, and now the shed goes flying. Why does the shed move now? Because the truck is applying such a big force in the positive x direction that no matter how hard the shed tries, it cannot exert a big enough force in the negative x direction. And when we set up the free body diagram so that the sum of the forces are equal to force of the truck minus the force of the shed, we do not get zero. We have more force in the positive direction. Static friction is overcome and the shed goes flying. Let's look at this from an equation perspective. Static friction, written as lowercase f sub s, is the amount of opposing force that an object can apply. The opposing force will always be less than or equal to the force applied. If you hit the shed with a tiny force, like your pinky, the shed will counter with a tiny force of friction, equal to your pinky. If you body slam the shed, the opposing force goes up, equal to the force of your body slam. But if the opposing force is so strong that the shed cannot match it, that's when force of static friction is less than the force applied. We overcome the static friction and the object starts moving. If the force of static friction is equal to the force applied, then the object is not moving. If the force of static friction is less than the force applied, the static friction is overcome and the object goes into motion. And that is because every object has a maximum resistance, where, for example, a dollhouse will have a tiny static friction, a shed will have a massive static friction. Why do we say less than or equal to? Why doesn't the shed automatically apply a maximum static friction? Very simple. If you push the shed with a pinky amount of force, and the shed opposes with a body slam counterforce, wouldn't the shed push you? What if the object is already moving? That's where kinetic friction comes in, which is lowercase f sub k, to resist a moving object and ultimately slow it down until it comes to a complete stop. I like to go walking on my brakes, and the recent blizzard didn't stop me. Problem was, what came down as snow, piled up on the ground, melted, and then froze into ice. Which means I had to be very careful, because if I stepped on the ice, I found myself sliding forward. What happened? With every step, I had forward momentum, and that means I had some force in the positive x direction. Say, instead of stepping onto a patch of ice on the sidewalk, I went ice skating with my shoes instead of ice skates. If initially I found myself sliding, assuming I didn't fall flat on my back, Eventually, the slide would get slower and slower until I came to a complete stop. So what happened here? When I stepped onto the ice and started sliding, I had motion in the forward direction, and that means I had some force applied, the force of me stepping onto the ice. However, the moment I stepped onto the ice, the kinetic friction of the ice starts opposing my motion, and if I'm sliding forward, the ice pushes back. I slide forward a little more. The ice keeps pushing back until the ice has applied so much kinetic friction that I ran out of energy, I ran out of motion, and came to a complete stop. Why doesn't this happen on concrete or grass? Very simple. Every object will have a coefficient of friction, which tells you how hard it will work to resist something moving on that object. That is represented by the letter mu. We have mu sub s for the coefficient of static friction, how much something will resist an object starting to move, and mu sub k for the coefficient of kinetic friction, how strongly the object will oppose something that is already moving. As you can imagine, ice will have a lower coefficient of friction, while something like wood would have a much higher coefficient of friction. Mu sub s will always be greater than mu sub k, because it's much more difficult for an object to start moving, but once it's going, it wants to continue going. Think about studying. It's hard to sit down, but once you're already in the zone, it's very easy to keep going. Objects are the same way. Which brings us to the equation for friction, where the force of friction, static or kinetic, is equal to mu sub k or sub s times n. F is the force of friction, K represents kinetic, but an S would represent static, is equal to mu, the coefficient of friction, sub K for kinetic, sub S for static, times N, which is the normal force. Let's take a look at the coefficient of friction. If we look at waxed wood on wet snow, mu sub S is equal to 0.14, mu sub K is equal to 0.1. What does this tell us? That waxed wood, like a sled to go sledding, has 0.14 as its coefficient of static friction, but 0.1 as the coefficient of kinetic friction. Notice that static is greater than kinetic. That is because it's much more difficult to get an immobile object to start moving than to slow down an object that already has momentum. We expect something to slide easily on snow, which is why the coefficients are very low. But if I look at something like steel on steel, the coefficient of static friction, mu sub s is equal to 0.74, but mu sub k is equal to 0.57. Notice that I didn't give you any units for the coefficients, and that's because it's a ratio of how much it wants to move versus how much it doesn't want to move, and the ratio doesn't have any units. Luckily, synovial joints have a mu sub s of 0.01 and a mu sub k of 0.003 because we need to be able to move. Back to our equation. Mu sub k times n. Remember that n is the normal force, f sub n or simply n, which is equal to mass times the acceleration of gravity. To set up a problem dealing with friction, we start with our free body diagram, or just simply put a point, and apply all your forces. In the downward direction, we have the force of gravity. In the upward direction, we have the normal force. In the positive direction, we have the force applied. This would be your motion or your attempt at motion, body slamming a shed. In the negative x direction, we have the force of friction opposing the force of motion. When dealing with an object on a horizontal plane, the y direction is very simple. If the object is resting on a surface, meaning it's not going down into the ground or up into the air, then the sum of the forces in the y direction are equal to zero, and that is because the force of gravity is equal to the normal force, meaning mass times the acceleration of gravity is equal to n. The problems typically come up when we look at forces in the x direction. For static friction, if an object is not moving, then the sum of the forces in the x direction are equal to zero, and that is equal to the force applied minus the force of static friction, which you can simply write as force applied is equal to the force of static friction, and force applied is equal to mu sub s times n. In the case of kinetic friction, in the x direction, when the sum of the forces is not equal to zero, that's where you get your mass times acceleration. Recognizing that acceleration is going to be negative because it's technically a deceleration. If I'm sliding on the ice and the ice is slowing me down, my acceleration goes lower and lower and lower until I come to a complete stop. Ready to try a practice problem? If yes, first give this video a thumbs up, subscribe to my channel, and make sure you hit that bell notification so that you don't miss out on any new videos. And then, let's take a look at this. A hockey puck is sliding on the ice at 6 meters per second. How far will it travel before coming to a complete stop? We're given two variables, mu sub k is equal to 0.17, and mass of the puck is equal to 160 grams. Before you even start the problem, ask yourself, what are we looking for? How far will it travel tells me I'm looking for a delta x, and coming to a complete stop tells me that v final is equal to zero, knowing that v initial is 6 meters per second. Let's set up a free body diagram, starting with our hockey puck and forces in the y direction. In the downward direction, we have the force of gravity. In the upward direction, we have the normal force. They cancel out, so we know that the sum of the forces in the y direction is equal to zero. The puck isn't going down into the ice or up into the air. For the puck to come to a complete stop, something has to slow it down. And that means if we have a velocity initial of 6 meters per second, velocity final of 0 meters per second, there has to be an acceleration, because the change in velocity over the change in time is equal to our acceleration, in this case negative acceleration, because it's going down. What causes that deceleration? That is the force of friction, and that is what we're solving for. The force of kinetic friction is equal to mu sub k times n, which is also equal to our mass times acceleration. We're about to bring in kinematics, and if that's something you're not comfortable with, go back to my other video series at layerforsci.com/kinematics, link below. How do we know that it's equal to ma and not zero? Simple. We have a change in acceleration. How does this help us solve for delta x? Very simple. If we find our deceleration, we can use that to find our delta x, which makes it a two-part question. Let's start by solving for, and therefore isolating, acceleration. This means we bring m over to the other side, giving us a new equation. Acceleration is equal to mu kn, which I'll remind you is mu k times mg, divided by m. That was convenient. M drops right out, giving me mu k times g. We were given mu k of 0.17, and we know that gravity is equal to 10 meters per second squared. Using the decimal trick that I teach in the math videos linked below, we get our acceleration is equal to negative 1.7 meters per second squared. Don't forget the negative because it's slowing down. Now that we have acceleration, we turn this into a new problem, where our given is as follows. Acceleration is equal to negative 1.7 meters per second squared. V final is equal to zero. V initial is 6 meters per second, and our unknown that we have to solve for is delta x. Using the which kinematic equation trick that I teach in the video link below, we're going to use the time-independent equation as follows. V final squared is equal to V initial squared plus 2a delta x. So let's isolate for delta x. Subtract V initial squared on both sides, giving us V final squared minus V initial squared is equal to 2a delta x. Remember that V final is zero. And since a is negative, instead of dealing with that negative sign, just say this is negative, they cancel out to give us a positive delta x. Let's keep isolating, divide both sides by 2a, which tells us that delta x is equal to V initial squared over 2a. Let's plug in the numbers. V initial is 6 meters per second, square the whole thing, divided by 2 times the now positive acceleration, 1.7 meters per second squared. Let's ignore the units for a moment. 6 squared is 36, divided by 2 times 1.7. This is where you have to get a little creative. You can either recognize that 2 times 1 is 2, 2 times 0.7 is 1.4, giving me 3 to 0.4. Or you can round it and say 1.7 is close to 2, and 2 times 2 is 4, so something under 4. But I'll use my first trick for 3.4. 36 over 3.4 is complicated, but remember, on the MCAT, close enough is good enough, which means if I estimate this to be about 36 over 3.6, you can either recognize that 36 is 10 times larger than 3.6, or combine two of the tricks that I teach in the math series linked below as follows. Move the decimal one space to give you 360 over 36. Cancel out the 36 to give you 10. Cancel out the 36 to give you 1. 10 over 1 is 10. Giving me a delta x is equal to 10. We expect the units to be meters, but let's take a look. Meters per second squared means we square the whole thing. Giving me meters times meters over seconds times seconds. If we're dividing by meters per second squared, the second squared cancels this. Meters cancels the green meters, leaving me just meters, as expected. While this problem had a lot of math, I want to argue that it was pretty straightforward. Hopefully you'll agree with me after going through it one or two more times. But what happens if you're given a problem on an inclined plane, where motion is going down the plane, friction up the plane, but gravity is going straight down, which means gravity is also opposing friction? That's exactly what we'll cover in the next video, which you can find linked below or by visiting my website, layerforsci.com/forces. The link again, layerforsci.com/forces.